Yeah.
Hi, everyone. I'm Jan Kabili. Welcome to the Photoshop Show. Tonight, we have Ron Clifford. Hi, Ron.
Hello. How are you?
Good to see you, Ron. You look tired. Are you tired?
I am a little tired tonight, yeah, actually.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that. Well, I'm glad you're here. I always enjoy seeing you. And we're so lucky to have Mr. Sean Duggan down there as our panelist.
Hey there. Sean.
And in just a few minutes, we're also going to have a special guest, and that is David Biedney. And David Biedney is the answer to the trivia question, who wrote the first Photoshop book ever? Did you know that, Sean?
I did, yeah, I did.
Did you? I
don't have that one, but I've got another one.
You have another one of his books there?
Yeah, another one of his books, which we can mention, although it's out of print, so it's going to be hard for people to find. But if they ever find it, it's well worthwhile to pick up.
Well, why don't you go ahead and pick it up and show us? You've got it right there, don't you?
I do have it right here, right there. This is called Photoshop Channel Chops.
Very cool. So have you actually read that book?
I have. It's actually by David Biedney, Bert Monroy, and Nathan Moody. And I learned so much about channels, alpha channels, and masking in this book. It's just a great book. I'm trying to see when the publication date, what it is. Oh, 1998 is the publication date on this. But it's currently out of print. But even though it is, what's that now? 1998, we're almost going on 14 years old, 13 years old or whatever. More than that. It's a great book. Highly recommended for you Photoshop geeks out there.
That's really cool. You know, he actually wrote a book long before that. He wrote a book when Photoshop was, in fact, not even a publicly available program. And that book, if I remember, is called The Adobe Photoshop Book. So when he gets here, he'll tell us more about that. That's pretty intense. Pretty intense. I don't even know what year that was. What year is Photoshop?
1990, I think.
Something like that.
Yeah.
Doesn't seem that long ago, really, does it? Doesn't to me, anyway.
Time flies when you're pixelating.
See, I was. Some people know I was a photo restoration artist and retoucher when Photoshop was being introduced, and it actually changed my career path. not for the better at the time, but it's getting better now.
So you were a traditional restoration artist?
I had a dark room and a studio and a copy stand and airbrushes and pencils and dyes. And yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
That is really cool.
Yeah.
That's pretty cool. Okay, so what is going on? Oh, so a couple of things before David comes and joins us. I wanted to tell people that I'm really excited that I have a couple new Lynda.com courses that have come out since the last time we were here just 2 weeks ago. And those are courses that we call project courses. They're short courses, just about an hour each. And this is something new for me because I'm used to doing the great big huge Lynda.com courses that go on and address many features. This is another approach. This approach is to take one photo and walk through it from start to finish. I think that a lot of people like that, especially if they know a little bit already about Photoshop, about Lightroom. They want to see, like, okay, what's the workflow? What do you actually do once you have the features under your belt? So that's what I tried to do. One of those courses is called Enhancing a Travel Photo with Lightroom and Photoshop. So I take a photo that I actually shot in Venice. It's not a very good photo. I hope people will excuse that and not think I'm a terrible photographer, but I picked a bad photo on purpose. And then I show how I would work on it, starting in Lightroom and following up with Photoshop, and why I would go to Photoshop and what I might do there. So that's one of those courses.
Sounds like a great course.
It was really fun. I thought it was going to be, you know, so hard for me to do, and in fact it was really easy to do. Because I do it all the time.
Yeah. Good idea.
Thank you. And then another course is enhancing a landscape photo with just Lightroom. And that course does more of a deep dive on Lightroom features, going beyond just the global corrections into the local corrections as well. So yeah, that's out there. And I hope you enjoy it.
Cool.
And like every Lynda.com course, there are a couple of free movies available for those courses. They are on the Lynda.com Facebook page. I hate to say it, Facebook page. You can access them. They're also Lynda.com YouTube page is where you can go to find those, and I'll put them on my YouTube channel too.
Cool.
Yeah, so I'm excited. What about you, Sean? What have you been up to lately?
Oh, I've just been catching up on some projects that I'm working on. Not that I can necessarily talk about those publicly right now. They're in a secure location, as we like to say, with projects like that that are still under wraps. And I've been experimenting a lot with some of the video techniques in Photoshop, doing a little bit of experimentation with those. I'm trying to make a little video experimentation, you know, at least once a week, and it doesn't have to be anything finished or full-featured. It's just sort of like I'm always trying to push the envelopes about what is possible with video in Photoshop. So I just do little animations and come up with interesting ways to create transition and blends between videos, and I'm just trying to sort of push it out and see how far I can push it without having to take it into, you know, a more robust video editing program like After Effects. So having fun with that.
Well, I think that's so great because that's an area, as you know, that hasn't been explored much in public. You know, people are doing it, but you don't see a lot of instruction about it.
It's just kept in the dark back alleys, you know, out of the public view.
I don't know why. Well, I think it's because photographers have just started with DSLR video. Before, you had video geeks doing it, right?
Right.
But they don't want from Photoshop. They want to use Premiere or some other Final Cut, whatever. So now that us photographers are doing it, it's like a new world and a new audience, and so there aren't too many people who are offering instruction in it, and it would be a wonderful, you know, I would love to see you be doing more tutorials on that. I certainly would watch them.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. Stay tuned. More on that front is percolating.
I'm sure it is. So out there in... I was going to say TV land, but that's not appropriate. Out there in Google Plus land, you probably don't know that Sean and I just got to spend some time together because he was here in Boulder, Colorado, where I live, and we had a great conference here, the ADIM conference. And so Sean was here, and I was just sitting next to him just drooling, watching the wonderful things he was doing with his photos and with video in Photoshop. And he taught me some stuff, and it was really great. So ever since we... parted, Sean, from that conference, I've been experimenting with video.
Cool.
Stuff, yeah, because you inspired me.
Yeah, well, what's great, there's a lot you can do, and if you already know some of the basics of Photoshop, like layers and layer masks and blend modes and stuff like that, all of that stuff is directly applicable to, you know, playing with video. And so if you already know some of those basic kind of core techniques in working with photos in Photoshop, it's not that hard to kind of get up and running and figure out how video works, and that's what's so fun about it.
Right. An example would be you can put a filter on an entire video, right?
Yeah. And an adjustment layer or, you know, a blending mode, something like that. Yeah, very, very cool stuff.
So you could turn like a color video into black and white. Easy.
Right. Yeah. Very easily to do. I mean, insanely easy to do.
Well, what I really like that I saw you doing is adding still photos as layers on top of a video layer in Photoshop so that the video is playing, but then you have these still things sitting on top of that. That looked really cool.
Yeah, well, that's sort of, you know, kind of an extension of my interest in compositing, and I really kind of got into that when I was working on the Photoshop Masking and Compositing book that I co-authored with Katrine Eisman and Jim Porto, which came out last September. And so I just took my natural interest in creating still image composites, and I thought, well, what can I do to push this a little bit further? And could I, like, combine my still image composites with video or video with my still composites to create essentially a moving composite? And my sort of prior interest in special effects in cinema and filmmaking also led me to go down that path.
Well, it's a great path. And, you know, what you have, Sean, that some of us who use Photoshop don't have as much as well, it's just this great artistic sense. And it's just wonderful to see what you do. And I always tell students, you know, I can teach you how to use the program, but you need to bring your sensibility to it and your experience in other art mediums, whether that's still photography, bringing those, you know, those skills to video, or bringing painting skills, composition skills to Photoshop compositing. It's important.
Yeah, you have to, you know, once you learn the skill set and the basic dance steps of how to do certain things or how to use the tools or whatever, you got to make it your own, and you bring your own creativity and sensibility to it, absolutely.
It's true. So let me ask you, have you been playing with the Lightroom 5 beta at all?
Oh, I have, yeah. A lot of really great new features in that. I mean, very, very impressive upgrade.
What do you think? Last week I was showing the radial filter, and of course, I had just gotten the program that day, and then we went on the air, so, you know, I hadn't really explored it that much. What do you think about the radial filter? Have you played with it?
Yeah, I have, and I love it. It's just it's great, and it's something that I've probably apart from the new healing brush, you know, retouching tool capabilities that they put in there, that was probably like high up on the list of my wish list for, you know, if I could have something new in Lightroom, what would it be? Because, you know, I was always sort of frustrated by the fact that if I wanted to add a vignette to an image, it was just sort of applied to the whole image. And if I had a subject off-center, I couldn't really deal with that. And it also just extends, you know, just beyond the idea of a vignette, it extends the whole idea of creatively dodging and burning to, you know, guide the viewer's eye by applying certain color or tonal adjustments to certain parts of the image. So it's just very flexible. It's great that you can easily invert it to affect, you know, the actual object that you've drawn the radius around. And I also like the effect that you can, you know, in addition to tonal adjustments, you can actually use the focus slider or the sharpness slider to slightly defocus, you know, the background of an image and create that kind of nice, I mean, it's not as extreme as, you know, what you get by having a shot made with a lens with a wide open aperture, you know, that super shallow depth of field, but you can add a slight defocusing effect to the background. So I think it's a great improvement.
Yeah, I noticed that. I think Katrine Eisman, who was also at that conference, was talking about doing that.
Yeah.
Yeah, I saw that. The other feature that's in Lightroom 5 that I haven't demoed on this program yet is the Advanced Healing Brush, which really is just the spot removal tool with the ability to remove non-circular spots.
Right.
And that's what I've been playing with. But, you know, I haven't had the greatest luck with it. Have you been trying that?
You know, it's situational. It sort of works well on some areas, not as well on other areas. So I think the important thing for people to realize about this is that, you know, it doesn't totally remove the need to go into Photoshop for more complex or precise retouching tasks. It works amazingly well on some things, but, you know, there's some types of retouching where it's going to have problems with it, especially if it's a little bit more extensive. So it doesn't, you know, it's not like, that used to be one of the main reasons why people who spent most of their time in Lightroom would have to go into Photoshop. And so they might be thinking, oh, now I don't have to go into Photoshop anymore, so what's the need of Photoshop? But, you know, if you have any sort of precise retouching or retouching where you really need to have total control over how it's applied, you're still going to need to go into Photoshop. But it is a pretty impressive advance for the spot removal tool.
Yeah, I agree. But I really think that there is a need to go to Photoshop, a strong need. For example, the only place I've really had luck with that spot healing brush working on a non-circular area is over sky and clouds, where there may be a little bit of a pattern because of the clouds, but it's nothing extreme, and there's lots of room to drag the source part of the brush. That seems to work. But then if I take and extend that same line over, say, a tree, I end up sometimes getting just a blur.
Right.
So, yeah, I don't know what's with that. And maybe because it's just in its first iteration, maybe because it's still in the beta, and maybe there will be some improvements after the beta. I don't know.
I had some good luck with it retouching. I removed in this one image a tent. There were some campers by a tent, and it was this, you know, otherwise sort of pristine scene out in the wilds of Iceland. And I removed this tent and someone standing right next to the tent. And for that, I was able to get a pretty good result because there was lots of area on either side of the tent of this sort of, you know, grassland area, this, you know, close crop grass, where I could choose to sample from. And also the tent was in, you know, the background. It wasn't up close. It was way in the background. So for that particular image, it worked really well. And actually, I was surprised at how well it worked. But again, that's what I mean by, say, it's a situational, or the effectiveness of that that new tool and those new capabilities is situational. It just sort of depends on the situation you're giving it in a particular image. Sometimes it'll work great, other times, less so great.
Yep, that's true. I totally know what you mean. And the same is true of the tool that I was going to show people tonight, which is this new upright feature that they have. Sometimes right. it works great, and sometimes nothing happens at all, and sometimes you get a weird result. So, you know, these are sort of just the beginning, the first time they've tried these tools in Lightroom, so is to be forgiven, and hopefully they will improve. But they're going down the right path, I think. So before we go on, I wanted to ask Ron. Ron has been talking to our guest, David Biedney, who is having some kind of connection problem. What's happening, Ron?
Yeah, I don't know. This is a mystery. We haven't had this kind of technical difficulty since probably our second or third Photoshop show. David has tried three separate browsers and the most current plugins and updated all his browsers, rebooted his computer, and for whatever reason cannot get to join a Hangout.
Oh, bummer.
It crashes every time.
Oh, my gosh.
And so he's going to continue trying while we carry on, but in the event he's not able to, he'll have to reschedule.
Oh, I'm so sad.
Yeah,
Well, we will definitely ask him to reschedule if he's not able to join us. And to the extent, Ron, that you can slip out again and help him if need be, that would be great.
Okay.
I don't know if he'll be sending us email or how he'll try to communicate.
Okay. I know, just to let you know, Dave is watching us tonight, our regular panelist, but he's marking papers with one eye, and with the other eye, he's keeping an eye on me and make sure I run the show right. So.
That's great. Okay.
Yeah.
Well, why don't we just continue on, and if David Biedney can't join us, we're so lucky we have Sean Duggan. I mean, you can't, you know,
yeah.
Here he is, the master himself. So what I was going to do, as I always do, is show a little bit of a tutorial. And so I'll go ahead and do that. Sean, can you spend some time and, you know?
Yeah, sure. Oh, cool. I can hang out. Thank it's a hangout, so I can hang out.
Yeah, let's hang out. Okay, cool. So I'm going to share my screen. And Sean, please, you know, break in and give me your thoughts. I mean, you know, certainly... certainly as much as I do about this particular feature because it's brand new, so we'll work on it together.
All right.
So can you guys see Lightroom now?
I can see Lightroom.
Yeah, and it's so clear. I'm so happy.
Yay. Okay, so I just went through my photos and looked for photos where I had a problem with perspective. You know, I'm really short, and so oftentimes when I shoot photos, they look crazy. They have this kind of I mean, here's an extreme example of the kind of problem that I run into is this, you know, where the things are leaning backward like crazy because I'm way, way down low when I'm shooting up. And, you know, the same is true in other photos. Like even this one, I believe I shot this with a pretty wide angle lens. You can see over here under the histogram. And, you know, I'm obviously shooting up. And what else do we have? Here's another one. I took this in Nice. Isn't that cool? Do you see that girl there? I didn't even notice when I took this picture. Let me see if I can zoom in on her. I don't know what she was doing. Some kind of dancing up there. You know, but this is not as extreme, but it still looks like a kind of an odd perspective. And here. So here's one that I took in Paris. And it's not bad. It's not leaning back too much. This is the, what do they call that thing? The Odeon Theater. And, you know, I wanted to be sure to get a wide shot in case I had to do some lens correction. It would give me room to try to bring the building upright more. And in that case, I'm probably going to lose some of the stuff on the side. So I did use a wide-angle lens, and I ended up with this kind of leaning back version of the theater. And, as you can see down at the bottom left and right, that lens vignetting that you often get with a wide angle. So until Lightroom 5, if I wanted to try to fix this in Lightroom, I would have to do that pretty much manually. Let's take this photo into the Develop module so we can see what's available to try to fix this.
So it looks like there's a could just be that that's the way the street was, but it almost looks like there's a slight curvature to the road, you know, right where the people are kind of crossing from the smooth part of the road back up onto the back part of the road there.
You're absolutely right. There is a curvature to this road. It was like a half-circle road.
Oh, I see.
Yeah. So if I go over to the lens correction panel in Lightroom's Develop module, let me actually close some stuff so you can see that better. In the past, I was kind of limited to going to the profile tab and enabling profile corrections and hoping that there was a lens profile out there for my camera and my lens. However, I think I shot this with the Olympus OMD, and no, there is no profile available out there. You can see it says none. Kind of sucky. And I don't even have an option to get an Olympus camera from this menu. So that's not going to help too much. So yes, you could build your own lens profiles, but give me a break. I'm not going to, you know, I'm too busy. Do you ever try that? Do you ever try that, Sean, building your own?
I've dabbled with it a little bit, but most of the time, you know, it's the same reason that you just gave. I'm too busy, and, you know. And fortunately for me, the lenses from my Canon system are all well profiled, so I haven't had to do that.
You see, that's what you get when you're cutting edge and have a cool new Micro Four Thirds camera.
There you go. There you go. You're just out there on the bleeding edge, Jan.
But that camera's great. Did you see the photos I took at Adam?
Yeah, I did. There were some great pictures, yeah.
They came out really good because, you know.
No, I was impressed with it.
I was amazed because I was on the run. I mean, you saw, I was like, run up, take a picture, run back before anyone, you know, I got in the way of anyone.
Right.
Yeah, it did some good stuff. Okay, so anyway, so here's the picture. So then what are we going to do? So in the past, that's not going to work very well. I could go into the manual tab and start dragging sliders around, you know, but that's like a real pain, and I don't have time. I want something automatic, and that is the new feature included under the new basic tab in the lens correction panel that's called the upright feature. You can use this feature to fix this kind of leaning back behavior that you get, what is called keystoning, when you're shooting up at buildings, or when you're or when you're using a wide-angle lens. And you can also use it when you just get a crooked horizon. So let's see how it works. The first thing they tell you to do when you're using the lens correction feature, or with this new upright feature, is to, in the basic tab, check off enable profile corrections. In this case, I don't think that's going to do anything. But if it did recognize my lens and camera, that would give the upright feature kind of a head start. So that's the first thing. And then the advice is also from Adobe to check off remove chromatic aberration, which is that kind of green and or purple line that you can get sometimes in high contrast areas. Can you describe that better, Sean?
Put you on the spot. I mean, in a nutshell, what chromatic aberration is the and it happens more so in wide angle shots and also in lenses that are, you know, cheaper and not as good, but at the outer edges of the frame, or at the outer edges of the picture, the optics are not focusing the different colored wavelengths of light equally. And so along high contrast edges, you know, going out from the center out along the edges, you'll sometimes get these either yellow purple color fringes around contrast edges, or sometimes it's a cyan red fringe. And so that's what chromatic aberration is. Unfortunately, it's not something you often notice until you make a big print. So it's always good to check your images ahead of time in Lightroom here or in Camera Raw. And just for good measure, it is always good to check that checkbox so that you'll remove it on a case-by-case basis if it is there.
That's great advice. And that's why when you were talking, I had zoomed into one-to-one view and I was panning around to see if I saw any. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I kind of saw something, but I wasn't sure if that was it. Certainly doesn't hurt to check this box just in case there is some that, as you say, we can't see till we make the print. So, and thank you. That was a great explanation. I'm sorry to put you on the spot, but of course.
No worries.
Yeah. Okay, so then the next thing I'm going to do after checking those boxes is I'm going to come down to the these, I don't know what to call them, they're rectangles.
Buttons,
yes. And they're, right now, the upright correction button is set to off. So at this point, normally, all I would do is click the auto button. Now keep your eye on the photo as I click auto. Did you see that change?
Indeed.
So let me do that again. Here's off, and here is auto. So usually, often, auto would do a pretty good job of straightening up a vertical leaning back photo with the keystone effect or leveling off a crooked horizon. And it did do an okay job in this case. And the official explanation of the auto feature is that it's going to try to straighten out your building in this case, but it won't go so far as to terribly distort the image. In other words, it's going to try and kind of keep it the way it might look to a human being looking at it. And that is different than this button right under it called full. So sometimes using auto just doesn't do anything, or it doesn't get you where you need to go. And in that case, the next step is to try full. So if I click full, I get a different effect. Let me do that again. There's auto, there's full. And what full is going to do is a more extreme correction, a stronger correction. And it made it a little different in this case. I don't think it looks any better. Let's look again. Auto, full.
I think you'd probably notice it more in an image that had more kind of more of a noticeable tilted back look to the building. That one was fairly subtle. It might show up better in some of your other ones in Venice.
I think so too, and I can show you on another one in a moment. But because it's really hard for me to evaluate these things, what I like to do is turn on another new feature, which is a grid overlay. In the past, you could only get the grid overlay when you were in the crop tool, but now you can turn on a grid overlay at any time. And you can either do that with keyboard shortcuts, Option, Command, and O on the Mac, which is Alt, Control, and O on the PC. Or, for those of you who want to see where that is, under the View menu, if you come down to Loop, let me see, yeah, Loop Overlay, here you can activate the grid. So let's go ahead and do that. So here we have a grid here, and that grid can help you tell what's straight and what's not. So let's put this back to off. And boy, you can really see how things are not vertically straight for sure, and not even horizontally really straight. And then if you want to, if this grid isn't doing it for you, you can change the size of the grid and the opacity of the grid. If I press the Command key on the Mac or the Control key on the PC,
I think the computer default muted you, Jen.
The computer default muted me.
Yeah, that new feature is actually a little bit of a pain. If it hears you click, it's going to mute you.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, hear you fine now.
Ah, that's interesting. All right, well, what I did is I quietly clicked. Can you hear me now?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, just click quietly.
So was it the click or was it the command key that did that?
It's the click. The new feature of Hangouts is if it suspects you're typing, it'll automatically mute you.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah.
Those Google engineers are just too clever.
Are you there, Jan? It muted you again.
Can you hear me now?
Yep.
All right. Quietly. When I click on that.
Yeah. It seems to do it every time. You're muted again.
God. All right. Well, look. Can you hear me now?
Yep.
All right. So what you can do, I won't show you. I'll just say it. You can hold the Command or Control key. It brings up that heads-up display where it says grid, and then it says size and opacity, and you can change the size and opacity of this overlay grid so that it can help you to better straighten up your photo. Once you've done that, then you have a guide to go by as you click auto to get that result, or full to get that result. There is also another option here, or two more actually. So let's go back to off. If this photo was not straight horizontally, if I clicked level, that would try to level it out horizontally. That was interesting, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Level. And but this level option doesn't try to fix the keystoning effect. And so vertical is another choice that tries to fix both keystoning and horizontal problems. So you get a little different look with each one of these. Understanding what it's doing under the hood can help you to choose among them, but honestly, I find they are so different on different images that you just have to try them out. So let's say that we went with this option on the vertical option. I'm going to turn off my grid so we can see that better. Option, Command, 0. Alt, Control, O on the PC. And I think the building looks really weird now. It's kind of bowed out or something. So if you get this kind of result, here's something you can try. you can add to the upright result your manual results. Or you could add your manual sliders on top of this. So you can go back to the manual tab at this point and try messing with the manual distortion or rotate or scale or aspect sliders. One thing you can do is use the new aspect slider. And as soon as I move over that, I get my grid back. And what this does, it can make the building look skinnier or fatter. So if I go to the left, bad result, it gets fatter. But if I go to the right, it kind of skinifies the building.
Skinifies. That's, I like that word, skinifies.
Well, I love being skinny. So when I'm going to try this on some portraits. So you could try skinifying it, and then you could also, maybe I would go to the rotate slider here and try dragging the rotate slider, and I've got that grid to go by, so that can help me. And then I might actually try the distortion slider too, seeing if I can get rid of some of what looks like a little bit of barrel distortion. So there we go. Now it's starting to look better. So just remember, if you don't like the result of upright, go to the manual tab and mess with the sliders. However, look what I have now on the right and left sides. I got some of this white stuff. And, you know, that's the result of distorting the photo. In that case, you can check constrain crop. And it will automatically kind of zoom the photo in, cropping away the edges. If you prefer to do the crop yourself, you can do that either here from the manual panel, or if you're working in the basic panel with the upright, you also have a constrain crop there. And you can choose to let it constrain for you, or you go up to the crop tool here in the toolbar under the histogram, or just press R. You can control the crop yourself. Now, who remembers, let's say I come in here and I try to fix the crop myself and I start dragging. Look how the aspect ratio stays the same, so that means I can't drag on one of these borders without dragging the whole thing, right? Do you know, Sean, how do you make it so you could drag individual borders separately in the crop tool?
You click on the little panel lock icon to unlock the aspect ratio.
Oh, Sean, you are too good. I can't trip you up.
Well, the other great shortcut for that is, which I didn't know for the longest time, is that, like, if you wanted to switch to a vertical, you just press the X key, and it will change the crop box to a vertical orientation with the current aspect ratio.
That is so cool. You're right. So I'm going to do that. I'm pressing X on the keyboard, and look, I can make a portrait orientation photo now, which often saves the day, right?
Yeah, yeah. Well, when I first started using Lightroom, I thought that you had to, you know, just sort of, there's a way you just keep dragging it, and then suddenly if you drag it far enough, you know, it kind of switches to a vertical, and I always thought that that was kind of odd, and then, you know, once I figured out, oh, I can just press X, well, that makes a lot of sense. That's my little tip.
That's a great tip. I agree. And no, how would you ever know that? I mean, you just have to listen to Sean Duggan. That's the only way.
And I listened to Julianne Koss, so that's how I found out about it.
Yeah, I listened to her too. Oh, and she was there. How cool was that, that she was there at that conference? I loved it.
Yeah, a lot of good people in Adam.
She's so good. All right, so anyway, I'm doing the X key again. Oh, here's something else about Julianne. Did you know that she does the Photoshop essential training courses on lynda.com? She did the one for Photoshop CS6, for example, and it's excellent.
Yeah, I did know that, and it's an amazing course. It's like really long. It's like tons of stuff in there. You can learn a lot.
God knows when she did that. When did she ever sleep?
I don't know. She probably did it while she was on an airplane somewhere flying back and forth.
Oh, it was horrible. Well, I'll tell you, one time I was lucky enough to get that assignment. I think I did it for Photoshop CS4, I did the essential training course. And I did it without much notice, too. And it was the best learning experience that I ever went through, I'll tell you.
Yeah, you learn a lot about something when you write a book about it or do a course on it.
Don't you? I know. All right, so anyway, so what we were talking about was that if you want to work on the crop yourself, by default, it's going to just resize. The crop is going to resize with the current aspect ratio. So if you want, you can go up to the panel that drops down when you're using the crop tool and click on that little lock icon to unlock it. And now I have the freedom to move these crop edges wherever I want. And, you know, I often want to do this unless I need a particular crop ratio. You know, say that you're going to print on a certain, within a certain mat, or you need a particular crop ratio for your website, then you would want to keep that checked. But otherwise, I want to get it to look the way I want it to look. So there we go. I'm now going to press Enter or Return keyboard, and there's the result. I can always go back and re-access the crop tool if I don't like the result, and just move things around. You know that clicking inside of the crop boundary in Lightroom is going to move the photo around in the crop boundary like that. That's how Photoshop works too, right? Is that right, Sean?
In Photoshop CS6, yeah. Not in older versions of Photoshop.
No, not in older versions. So, so now let's say I'm done with this photo. I'm going to go back to my grid view. And tell me, Ron, do we have David Biedney with us yet?
I know you want me to say yes, but no, I'm afraid we don't.
Bummer.
Jen Baptiste did join us. I don't know if you've seen her.
That's wonderful. Hi. Hi. Yeah. Hello. Thank you for joining.
Oh, my pleasure. It's such an honor to be here, and I'm learning so much, so thank you.
Oh, great. Well, all right, so since we don't have David, I think I'll show you one more image. Let's do it, as Sean suggested, on a really crummy image that's really lying back really far, which is this one. Now, I'm not proud of this photo. Caveat, caveat, right? Bad photo. Maybe John, I think my boyfriend John took this one, right?
Hey, it's well exposed, you know.
Yeah, kind of. He always does do good exposure, and he usually does great compositions. You know, I stand there waiting for hours while he makes it all perfect.
So we all have travel photos like that.
Right, so one of us goofed. All right, but let's see how the upright is going to do on this. So first thing, actually, let's see what camera this was taken with. How can we see? Let's go to the profile tab and enable the profile. Nope. I must have done this one. My bad. Because it must be with that crazy OMD camera. All right, so anyway, back in the basic tab, enable profile corrections, remove chromatic aberration, and come down to the upright, and let's see what happens when we do auto. There we go. It did quite a bit.
Yeah.
And it gave us those white areas on the sides, and to get rid of those, I can check constrain crop right here in the basic tab. And it will go ahead and constrain. So it still looks kind of goofy, but again, there's off, not good. There's auto, better. Let's compare off to something else, like level. So here's level. Now, what I do like about this is that it's showing this information down at the bottom, the red awnings and stuff, and I would like that to be in the photo, but it didn't straighten the horizon, and looks crummy. So again, let's go to off. Let's try vertical. Now, by the way, you don't have to keep going back to off. I'm just doing that so you guys can see, the difference between where we started and where we go. You could just go to level, and if you don't like that, go to vertical, like this. That's really good.
Yeah, as I understand it, what vertical does is it really tries to make, the lines that should be vertical, it tries to make them really vertical. So it's always going to be a little bit more extreme than the auto. So auto is going to be kind of backed off on that a little bit, so it's not going to be quite so extreme. And, in pictures like that, I'd say arguably this version of the picture is not as effective as a memory of that location in Venice as the original one, even though the original one was tilted back, because here you're losing the awnings and the kind of sidewalk ambiance, which is, I think, a key part of this particular image in terms of, remembering, that day in Venice.
Yeah, except for one thing, it's not Venice.
Not Venice. Paris?
No, I think it's Nice. It looks like Nice.
Oh, it's Nice. Okay, all right.
All right, so let's go back to off, because I think what I'm going to try to do here is put on the Option, Command, and Zero.
Oh,
I think that's going to help with this one. So now let's do the vertical. And you're right, because if you look, can you guys see this pipe over here? You see how the grid is right along that pipe.
Yeah, it's done a good job to make it vertical.
It did make that part vertical, but, the rest of it still looks crazy. So
not
now
that that's a good thing, necessarily.
Let's try another one. Let's try full. Now, full is that really extreme correction. I don't know what it's going to do. Let's see. Oh, that's interesting. I think I like that one.
That one's better, although you're still losing the nice awnings on the sidewalk.
You are. But so what you could do in that case is uncheck constrained crop. Let's go back to off and do full. And now you get the white things on the side. So, and you get the red awning. So now I could go and crop this myself rather than allow it to constrain the crop. I'm going to lose a lot on the sides, but that way I could organize things so I see what's on the bottom. So for example, if I go up to the crop tool or press R on the keyboard and I make sure that that padlock is unlocked, I can now come in and drag the right border over like this. I could drag the left border over like this. I lose a lot of the side information, but I don't care at this point. I'll press return, and I've got a straighter, upright, less keystone photo. Let me turn that. And I do have my awning stuff at the bottom. So I think that's not a bad compromise. You cannot have everything.
No, you can't.
You can't. But I also see that the top looks stupid. It looks all bowed out, doesn't it?
Yeah, a little bit of a barrel distortion looks like going on there.
So you know the solution. You go to the manual tab, right? And you do the distortion slider to the right. And that's how you normally would get rid of barrel distortion anyway.
And
now,
I would guess if your version, you know, if there was a profile available for that lens, I would guess that the lens profile correction probably would have addressed that. But in this case, you didn't have that. So you got to do it manually.
That's right. And I'm glad I have a lot of bad photos taken with an obscure lens, so that happens.
There you go.
So I have demo material. Okay, so look, so I've fixed that distortion along the roof line, and it's, but now that grid is telling me that it's not level horizontally, so I take the horizontal slider. Oops, sorry. I take the rotate slider, and we go this way. And I can get the roof horizontal, but not the rest, but let's go for that. And then I press enter or return on the keyboard. Then I constrain the crop. I think I liked it better with the roof crooked, didn't you?
Yeah. I think that would look better. What I always tell people about these things is that, you know, when you're trying to correct distortion in a picture, what you're doing is you're trading one distortion for another distortion. And you know, the first distortion is, of course, the distortion was created based on, you know, the optics of the lens and your relationship to the subject. You know, if it's a building, it's leaning back, it's got that keystoning effect. And then when you use you know, some distortion correction technique, whether it's in Lightroom or Photoshop, you're just basically trading the first distortion for another more acceptable distortion, but it's still another distortion. So sometimes that trade-off works, and you know, yeah, that looks good, I like that. Other times, especially if you're really close to the building and you're looking up at a much more extreme angle, then the trade is not really so successful, because then you just sort of get this really weird, you know, sometimes funhouse mirror type result.
You know, I really like the way you put that, and I think that there is some confusion out there about the two different types of distortion. So I want to emphasize what you just said, which is, first we saw the keystoning effect, that the building looked like it was leaning back, and that's the result of my perspective. The photographer is standing down low at the bottom. The other kind of distortion that we saw a moment ago, let me see if I can bring that back. Let's just undo, bring it back. Let's see. One more. And one more. I'm just backing up. There we go. This other kind of distortion, which is up here at the roof line where it looks like it's poofed up in the middle, that's the barrel distortion. And correct me if I'm wrong, Sean, but that is caused by the lens, not
my...
Yeah,
that's caused by the lens, yeah.
Yeah. So it's important to understand the different types of distortion you can get and then to go, you know, for the best compromise between the two. Now, you may like the photo straighter like this and with that kind of a bowed roof. It is totally a matter of taste. And what is the answer? Now, I'll tell you what I would really do if I had a lot of money and I weren't traveling and I could carry a lot of lenses with me. I would take, what are those lenses called, Sean?
A tilt shift lens.
Oh, Ron knows. What are they?
Definitely a tilt shift lens. That was the way you did it back in the day. They still do it for serious architectural work.
Yeah. Or they use view cameras that had tilts and shifts and swings on the camera.
That's right. The view cameras that, now you did the swing on the lens was coming out on a kind of a canvas with canvas
bellows
along the edges, right?
Yeah.
Do you have one of those?
I don't have one, but there was a lens board. You know, the lens was on the front of the camera, and then there was a bellows on a track, and then in the back of the camera was where the film holder was that held the sheet film, and then you could tilt the front of the the board that the lens is mounted on, you could tilt it up and down, left to right, and then you can shift it. Yeah. So you had all these controls, which gave you a great deal of flexibility and control in how the scene was rendered on the film.
It's true. Those were the old days before we had digital cameras that did everything for us. I kind of like that.
Well, digital doesn't do that for us. you still need the manual tilts and shifts to deal with that. Although you can, of course, to some extent, obviously, as you've been demonstrating, you can use the wonderful software capabilities in Lightroom, Photoshop, and other programs to address it at some level.
True. So, let's get out of here. I'm going to actually see if I can unshare my screen. Do you happen to have any photos that you want to share, Sean, or talk about or show features on? I know you weren't prepared for that, but...
I got this a late notice here. I don't have any photos necessarily. I do have one quick little, I mentioned those little video experiments that I'm doing. I can show one quick little video experiment if you want to see that.
Oh my God, that would be so great. We would love that.
So, it's just a real short thing, and it was kind of a little doodle I did last night, just trying to sort of figure out, what can I do with this?
I've been getting so much more interested in video lately, so, yeah.
All right. Animation.
While Sean is doing that, I want to tell you guys, he's just stepped in here at the last minute because we saw David was having trouble, and he is an amazing, remarkable friend and Photoshop expert. I am always awed at his capabilities. It's funny because one of the things that I posted before David Biedney came on the show, kind of a teaser, was who knows who wrote the first Photoshop book? And some people answered Jesus Christ.
Wow.
I don't think it goes back quite that far, but...
But I wouldn't be surprised if Sean Duggan had written that book, because honestly, of all the people that I know, Sean, you are among the most knowledgeable, and I totally admire you, and I think you should be way more famous than you are, and the only reason you're not is because you're such a nice guy.
Oh, well, thank you very much. Although I wasn't using Photoshop when it first came out, and David was, but I was using it shortly after it came out. I started using it in version 2, so it goes back a while.
Woo. Don't tell how old you are.
No, I won't. All right, so what do? I click screen share, right?
Yep, and you got to screen share your desktop, not the... Yeah.
Desktop.
Yeah.
So you tell me when you can see my...
And then once you hit desktop, don't forget... There you go. Click that part.
All right, you can see me now?
Yeah. Ooh, yeah.
Isn't that good? So... what I did was, again, this is just a short little experiment. I'm not going to go through it, the whole thing in depth. Maybe this will just be a teaser. It's something we can look at in a future episode. But I'll just show you what I did with this. I wanted to play around with taking a still photograph and just adding some animation to it. So this actually isn't working with video per se, as in video shot with a digital SLR. But it's creating video from a still photograph. So basically I'm going to be animating aspects of this particular picture right here. So let me go over to the layered file here and bring my timeline in. So can you see this one now?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So you can see that I changed the picture and I brought the ice fragment that was separate from the other picture, I brought it down to and positioned it sort of on the tip of that other ice fragment. And I started looking at this and I thought, well, gee, it would be nice to animate this so it was like, tilting back and forth like it was going to fall, and then actually animate it falling off of the tip of the iceberg or the ice fragment, certainly an iceberg. And I also like the fact that, this is on a black sand beach in Iceland, which incidentally is where I'm going to be teaching one of my Creative Discoveries workshops this coming June 29th through July 6th. So if anybody's interested in going to Iceland and having a fantastic adventure.
Me!
There you go. Go to my website, seanduggan.com, and there's a link there where you can click on to get information about that workshop. But anyway, so this is on a black sand beach, and I like the fact that it looked like kind of like night stars. And probably to make it look more like night stars, what I might do is actually remove the shadow of this ice fragment here just to make it look like night stars, because I like the abstract quality of that. But anyway, So what I did was I took the ice fragment and I selected it and put it on a separate layer. And again, I'm just going to give you a quick overview of this. I'm not going to go in and do the whole thing. And I then animated it. So what I'm going to do here in the timeline for the timeline panel here is I'm just going to scrub through this. And for those of you who have not yet used the video capabilities in Photoshop, you have your normal layers panel, just like always, where you have the different layers. And then you have a timeline, which is essentially the concept of working with layers over a span of time. So you can modify where those layers appear and when they're visible during the time span of the video. So for this, again, as I scrub through this here, what you're going to see happening is you'll see that down on this second layer here in the timeline that says layer one, there's these little diamond-shaped notations under it, and these are called keyframes. And essentially, what I did was I placed a keyframe at each of these points, and between each keyframe, a specific movement is being applied to this fragment up here on the tippy top of the ice piece. So as I move this, you can see that it's going to start to waver back and forth. Is that wavering coming through there?
Yes, it looks like it's going to fall over any minute.
Exactly. And so it's wavering, and then it gets to this point, and then gravity starts to take over, and then it really does start to fall.
Ouch.
And it falls down. So that was just me scrubbing through it. Let me just move it back to the beginning here, and I'll just click the play button, and we can see the whole thing play. Let me actually just make this a... let's see, let me view this at 100%, and I'll get the timeline out of the way and move my layers panel out of the way. That way we can see it all at full screen, and I'll just press the space bar. So there it's going to start tilting.
Boom.
So... the playback is always a little bit choppy when it's playing, but you know, I've rendered this out as an MP4 video file and played it back in the QuickTime player, and it looks pretty good. And so I redid this a couple times, and a lot of it was just sort of coming up with a motion that looked real for the way that this was falling.
Well, that's an interesting point. It's like, I don't, you know, I always have trouble with that. I don't know about graphic. I mean, that's more about graphics than photographs, right?
Or more about fit. Well, this the falling is more about physics, actually.
Physics, right?
You know, the weight of it, because when it first started to tip and fall in my first iterations, there was an oddness to the way it rotated, and I realized, wait a minute, you know, that's not going to work because the weight of this piece of rock or ice or whatever is always. You know, the most of the weight is up here in the end of the object that has more mass. So that's going to be the kind of guiding factor that's going to be pulling it down. So initially when I did this, it didn't look real when it fell. And I mean, not that it looks necessarily real now, but I'm happy with it for the moment in terms of it being an experiment. But you're right, Jan, in terms of just... in working with this, this is sort of now in the realm of pure animation. But it was easier to do than actual sort of stop motion animation where every single frame of that would had to be animated. Here I was able to just animate each discrete movement, and basically that is, you know, indicated by all these little keyframes here. You know, each one is a separate movement. One is going to be where it's going to tilt one way, then it tilts back the other way, et cetera, and then finally it falls. So it was kind of a fun little experiment, and I may take this clip further and do some other stuff with it, just to sort of, again, experiment further with this, and I might even bring in some actual video footage to this, too. So that's what
that's so cool. That's so cool. I love that. And, you know, I have to tell you, I really enjoy, you know, being part of seeing your creative process. It's really fun. I think this is great for the Hangout. Don't you think so, Ron? He says, yeah.
I think it was excellent for the Hangout. This is the kind of thing we throw back and forth. But I got to tell you, in the middle of that, there was one thing that was in my head, and I was trying not to laugh. You're going to hate me for this, but I kept this in the back of my head. I kept going, Lost in Space.
Yes, exactly. Well, you know, the other thing that I was thinking of doing here with this is that I thought that this here, you know, especially with the night sky, if I remove the shadow of this ice fragment on the beach, because this was photographed with me directly above this ice fragment shooting straight down at it. So if I remove this shadow so that it was all just this, you know, kind of black speckled sand that looks like stars, I thought, oh, and then I could like animate the shape of a ship coming in and striking this iceberg and thinking of doing that. So the fun thing about this is that, you know, it's a great way to explore the capabilities of the program and to explore the limits of an idea in terms of what you can do with it here with the video and animation capabilities that are in Photoshop. And it doesn't have to be a full-fledged sort of finished thing. It can just be this little, you know, improvisation. And it's kind of fun and satisfying. And, you know, but the main point was to play around and experiment and learn something and, of course, have a good time. And I did.
Well, you know, you make this great point, which is you have to try things. You can kind of understand how they work, but until you try them, you don't know, right?
Right. And, you know, there's obviously, if you really want to get into this sort of stuff in more depth, there are other programs, you know, such as After Effects, that offer a lot more capabilities and control. But for, you know, the average person who just has Photoshop, you know, again, if you know Photoshop layers and stuff, there's just a lot you can play around with and have fun with. And this is like, you know, me being a kid in a candy shop, because when I was a kid, I actually made stop-motion animated films with a 16-millimeter movie camera and, you know, did it the old-school way of, you know, actually moving each little thing, you know, each object in one frame at a time, and it's very, very tedious. And I still play around with that now and then, but to be able to actually take elements from still photographs like this and animate them using this keyframe technique in Photoshop, it's a lot easier, it's very fun, and it's just another way to kind of, you know, explore, you know, the visual image by adding motion to it. So I love it.
It is really cool. Hey, will you do something for us if you're done showing that before? Don't stop.
Don't stop.
Go back to screen. Photoshop.
Oh, that's true, because you were seeing that, so you were seeing multiple versions of yourself.
Yeah, right. Bad. I don't want to stop.
Tunnel vision.
No, but I want to see your the announcement of the workshop that you're teaching in Iceland. Yeah. Can you bring that up in your browser?
That's so exciting.
What, you mean the video, you mean?
No, the thing, the focus on nature thing.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Now, this isn't the first time you've done this, though, is it, Sean?
What, faked it? And
the Iceland, an Iceland workshop.
Oh, an Iceland, no.
Yeah.
I'll bring up a new one. There we go.
I'm pretty sure he's done this before.
I was in Iceland last summer on kind of a scouting mission.
Yeah.
Looking at what the terrain was like, and I was actually there with Julianne Kost on her workshop, so that was great. Got to hang out with Julianne Kost. And so anyway, if you went to my website, which is, again, seanduggan.com, right here in the middle, there's a link here to the workshop page. There's also a link to a video, but that'll take you to the Focus on Nature website, where there's information about the Iceland workshop, and there's also the video there as well.
Great. I mean, if I could go, oh my God, but unfortunately, I'm going to be in Europe at that point. So
oh, that's just terrible. Poor you.
I feel horrible for you, Jan.
Yeah.
And you know who's teaching in Europe? This is really cool. So Russell Brown is joining my friend Randy Braun. It looks like Brown, but it's Braun. And they're teaching in the Dolomites. So that's going to be really fun. That's and my God, I'm kind of thinking I need to steer my car from France over to Italy. Didn't see that.
Yeah.
So I just stopped my screen sharing. Am I stopped there now?
Yeah, you're here.
Yeah, there you are.
Awesome. Back.
There's so much great stuff going on this summer. So many places to go. So many wonderful people teaching. But Iceland is definitely on the bucket list. And
Yeah.
It's
yeah.
a beautiful place, and I'm really excited about the possibility of going back, and the people at Focus on Nature are just really great, and it really is just an astounding place to make pictures, because the light at that time of the year is, you know, some of the longest days of the year, and you have, you know, normally in the latitudes where we all live, here in the U.S., you know, sunrise and sunset, you know, kind of the really sweet hours of sunrise and sunset last, you know, and the sweet hours, sweet minutes, last maybe, yeah. you know, half hour, 40 minutes maybe, where you got the prime super great light. And at that time of the year in Iceland, sunrise and sunset last for like 3 to 4 hours of like primo gorgeous light. And just an amazing, amazing place. So it's going to be a great, great photo adventure.
Yeah. Well, good for you. I'm really looking forward to it. I wish I could come, you know, but at least I'll be watching and seeing what you guys are accomplishing. And on Facebook, I hope you're going to be posting the images that you take and that the students take.
Oh, definitely. And, you know, when we have time, it's definitely sort of a, you know, we're like out photographing a lot of the hours of the day because there are so many hours of daylight. But during the time where we're not photographing, we're actually having sessions where we are reviewing the images that we've made, you know, talking about what's working, what's not working, talking about ways to make them better, and also, you know, discussing Lightroom and Photoshop techniques for improving the images. So it's more than just a photo tour. We're actually, you know, delving into what makes, you know, some photographs work, what makes others not work, and how to improve them using the amazing software tools that we have.
Yep, the stuff that we learned in photo school, remember?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, all that. Plus Photoshop and Lightroom.
Yeah. Well, right. Just to remind, at about the same time, I'm going to be doing the same thing in Aspen. How nice is that?
Oh, cool.
At the Anderson Ranch Art Center, I'm teaching a week-long Lightroom workshop, but we also do shooting and talk a lot about that kind of important stuff, which is the photo, you know, the photo that was there before Photoshop. I hate to say it. Yeah. Ron, what about you? Are you doing Lightroom or Photoshop workshops this summer?
Actually, I got a couple of things coming up. I am returning to the First Nations camp for kids at the beginning of July. And so I'm kind of gearing up for that. And that's in an area, it's not quite the same as Iceland, Sean, but it starts getting dark, I don't know what time, around, you know, 8 o'clock. And it doesn't actually finish getting dark until 11:30.
Right.
Because the sun just kind of skims down slowly, slowly, slowly.
And where is that at?
It's north of Thunder Bay in Ontario.
Okay.
So it's up there. It's not way up there, but we have much longer days than we do down here where I am, just north of Toronto. Yeah. And it's right at that peak time when the days are longest anyway, so it's really odd to be up at 11 at night and still not have darkness. It's
it is strange.
So I'm doing
that.
And
when is that going to be again?
Sorry?
When are you doing that?
That's the beginning of July. I'll be going up also after that again to the Bruce Peninsula area, World Biosphere Reserve, for 2 weeks. That's just a stunning area full of real unique biodiversity. And in the meantime, I'm putting together some new mentorship courses that are going to be coming out in the next, I would imagine, 30 days. I've had a lot of interest coming off the end of this advanced mentorship. Jen is actually part of that. And I'm going to be introducing some new programs. So I'm really, really excited about the mentorship.
It's great that you're doing that, Ron. It's so generous of you, and I know you're a great teacher.
Thank you.
So, Jen, what? Are you taking the mentorship courses, or have you? You're muted. We can't hear you.
Oh, there it goes. I kept pushing the button. Yes, I participated in Ron's first mentorship, and then I did the advanced mentorship, and I've learned so much. I was an environmental geologist for over 10 years, and I'm transforming my life into becoming a photographer, and it's been a hobby of mine, and now I'm turning it into a business. And this will be my second annual wildfire flower safari that I'm going to be doing at the end of August, and I'm looking to turn that into a commercial effort, and I'm working with Ron on the mentorships and creating a program to empower all forms of mentoring. So just because it really is a powerful way to transform people's lives, make a difference. And so I've just I've got a lot that I'm creating, and my business is just genuine creations, and it really is just more and more of that. Anything that I can do to help empower people in the world to make a difference.
That's great. That's really wonderful. You know, we should talk sometime, because I used to be an environmental lawyer. Ah! And you guys made more money than we did, because you guys were like on the stand. What were they called? The litigation specialists or the expert witnesses? That's what it was.
Yes. I had many years of doing environmental work where groundwater was my passion.
And me too. Yeah, I did groundwater.
And I still love it. And I still love stormwater and all of that. And I really hope to take what I create into all areas, and including the environmental. So I have many passions and lots to learn. So you guys doing these programs and everything that you know, the mentors and everybody offer, they just make a huge contribution to people's lives. Really, they do. And so I'm just excited by the technology and what you guys do.
Well, I hope you'll join us again. You're welcome anytime as a panelist. Ron, please invite her. She's cool.
I will. She is cool. Of course she's cool.
Well, yeah. Ron's friends are all cool.
Yeah. Well, look, I want to thank you guys. I love you all. You're wonderful. Thank you for stepping in. Last minute, everybody was terrific. And Sean Duggan, Ron Clifford, Jen. And hopefully everyone will come back in a couple of weeks. I promise we will invite David Biedney again. We'll make sure his browser stuff is working, and he'll wow us.
Yeah.
But, John, you wowed us too.
Sorry. Wow. Well, thanks very much. Thanks for including me and the ability to contribute to the wow factor.
All right, then.
All right. Bye. Have a good night, everyone. Thanks a lot.
All right.
Thank you.